In this screencast, we will explore the concept of hydrostatic pressure, specifically how pressure varies throughout a fluid at rest. First, let's start with our general form of the equation of motion for a fluid in which there are no shearing stresses. You can see here where delta, or del, as an operator, of the pressure is our pressure gradient. And what this del operator implies is that we are looking at the pressure at all sides, and in this case a Cartesian system, that's applying to this fluid particle or fluid element. So we would be looking at the x, y, and z directions and looking at how the pressure varies across this element. Now gamma here is our specific weight for the fluid. And we're applying this only in the k vector, which is also our z direction. And so this is our component that accounts for the weight of the fluid particle. And lastly, we have this equal to rho times acceleration vector, and this is density. This is our acceleration vector. And again, with the vector, we are looking at all of our Cartesian coordinates. And you can see that this is just a force balance. We have our mass times our acceleration divided by a volume. So if we multiply both sides by volume, we would have force on the right side, mass times acceleration. For our specific weight, which is a weight per volume, we would therefore just have weight. And our pressure times a volume gives us a force. And you could check the units on that to verify. So again, this basically means that if we apply some kind of pressure gradient to a fluid element based on its weight and that pressure, we're going to cause that element to move. Now, if we take this fluid element and we say that it's at rest, so our acceleration term here is zero, and therefore we could rewrite this and show that our pressure is going to be only a function of this z component. So what's this mean? It means we would have the differential form of pressure as a function of z equal to the specific weight of the fluid. So we could rewrite this in the form of a ordinary differential equation. And this basically becomes the fundamental equation for fluids at rest. So let's take an example where you could imagine yourself in a swimming pool. And that swimming pool is going to have some depth. We're going to say z. So we'll say that the surface is z equals zero. And so if we wanted to plot what the pressure would be like on our body as a function of depth, right? So think about the pressure that impacts on your ears as you go deeper and deeper into the water. We can see that the pressure is going to increase as we go deeper into the pool. And hence, that's why we have this negative sign here that indicates that our pressure decreases as we go up an elevation or increases as we go down. So the same thing happens right now on your body. You have the force of all of this air weighing down on you, causing some kind of pressure specifically on your body. And as you go higher in elevation, there's less air above you to put pressure on your body. So the question becomes, how does the specific weight vary as a function of z? And can it? Well, since specific weight is a weight per volume, this is going to be a function of the density of the fluid. So if the density changes with elevation, then the specific weight will change with elevation. So for this video, let's just focus on incompressible fluids in which the density of the fluid is constant. In other words, not a function of pressure. So for most liquids, this is true. But for most gases, it is not. Hence why we could compress a gas so easily and change its density. If we integrate our equation above, so going back to our fundamental equation for a fluid at rest, we could separate variables and integrate. So if we integrate from, say, some z1 to some z2, and some p1 to some p2, we get p2 minus p1 is equal to the specific weight of the fluid, I'll put FL here for fluid, times the difference in elevation. Now I've taken out the negative sign and distributed it. Another way of writing this in the same thing is in this form, and the reason this might be more common is typically our z2 is going to be a higher elevation, so we'll keep the right side positive. The reason we do this, again, thinking of some location on our ground as our z1 and some higher elevation as z2, we can think about this change in elevation as just a height of our fluid, and we could write that as h. And so plugging that in, we'd have a new equation where we could say p1, pressure down here at the ground, is equal to p2, plus the specific weight of the fluid times the height of that fluid. Now let's think of a tube of fluid that we have. Let's just say water. And we take a little bit of water and we put it at the bottom. And it's going to have some pressure associated with that much water. Now as we add more water, that pressure is going to increase because the weight of this water is now acting downwards on the water below it. And since the fluid is at rest, that force must counterbalance the weight above it. So you can imagine that if we keep adding water, this force is going to get larger towards the bottom, and therefore the pressure at the bottom is going to increase. So all of the fluid particles stacked on top of each other are going to exert some kind of weight and therefore pressure on the fluid particles at the bottom. And since they're not accelerating, they're not moving, force has to counterbalance it. So the pressure at the bottom is going to be much greater than the pressure at the top. Now, if we think of this height of fluid as H, as we did before, we could refer to it as a pressure head or a head pressure. That is the height of the fluid at some specific weight that results in a pressure difference, P1 minus P2. And that's just rewriting this equation in that form. Hopefully this helps you understand why a unit conversion of 1 atm, 1 atmosphere, we could convert that to a head pressure of feet of water, which is roughly 33.9 feet of H2O. So what's that mean? It means if we had a column of water that's 33.9 feet high, then at the bottom, the pressure being exerted would be 1 atmosphere, or 33.9 feet of water. So with that in mind, let's take a look at an example where we have three containers, all having a fluid of height H, and they all have the same fluid that has a specific weight designated gamma FL. If we took this particle, and this particle, which particle is experiencing the highest pressure? Since our fluid is at rest, it's not moving in the X direction, the Y direction, the Z direction, it's not moving radially. Pressure is equal on all sides. So the pressure here, if we designate it as P1, is the same pressure here in this container because it has the same fluid height above it. Now, interestingly enough, if we look at this third container, if we drew this element in the middle, then you could see that there'd be very little argument that the pressure at this point would be the same as the other two containers because it has the same height of fluid above it. But if we look at this particle to the left that's below this curvature of the container, it must also have the same pressure, P1, because since there is no acceleration, the force, the pressure acting on the left and right side of this element must be the same, and therefore it's the same everywhere along that Z plane. So the pressure on the left side closest to the container wall is still the same pressure. So hopefully that gives you an idea of this concept of hydrostatic pressure, of that of a fluid at rest. And we'll use this as a basis for a lot of the work that we're going to do in our fluid dynamics. Take a look at some of the other screencasts on how we could utilize hydrostatic pressure as a mechanical advantage for things such as hydraulic jacks.